The following message has been brought to you by the Mile High Flood District. Grouted boulders are a mixture of large, quarried boulders placed closely together with concrete grout filling the voids between. Grouted boulders are used for stormwater improvements and stream stabilization along urban waterways and have become popular in the Colorado Front Range due to their natural design aesthetics, long history of successful applications, and our close proximity to high-quality rock sources. This video provides a background on the proper installation of grouted boulders along with common problems to look for during construction. As with any infrastructure design or construction technique, proper engineering design is vital to a successful outcome. Common applications of grouted boulders include drop structures along active waterways, boulder walls, stabilization of steep banks, and erosion protection in large culvert and storm sewer outfalls. Grouted boulders can withstand high velocities and turbulent flow conditions. Design guidance for sizing boulders is typically based on flow velocity, ground slope, and other site conditions. Guidance can be found in the district's criteria manual. The quality of rock and proper grouting procedures are very important to the structural integrity of the finished product. Proper subgrade preparation is critical to the success of a grouted boulder structure and its longevity. It's important to maintain optimum moisture content and proper compaction that meets specifications while preparing the subgrade to place boulders. It's also important to avoid frozen subgrade that could potentially fail compaction once the ground thaws. Grouted boulders are sometimes used along waterways that have been eroded over time and need to be filled in with soil to achieve proper subgrade elevations. They may also be built in areas of cut, such as when a stream or river is relocated back to a historic alignment or moved to a new alignment. A geotechnical engineer can provide guidance on achieving proper compaction and moisture content, but typically a contractor achieves proper compaction by placing the soil in 1 foot or less vertical lifts or layers and compacting each lift with heavy equipment. Excavators can be used when cutting to the proper subgrade elevation. The new subgrade may need to be ripped and recompacted with moisture to achieve proper subgrade prep even in cut situations. Grouted boulder drop structures require proper seepage control, typically achieved with steel sheet pile driven into the ground upstream of the crest. The district has other videos that describe seepage cutoff walls and steel sheet pile installations. Dewatering during subgrade prep is very important. District specifications require that any groundwater or nuisance water be removed from the subgrade before subgrade approval by the engineer and before boulder placement should start. Water must be kept off the subgrade 24 hours a day until the grout has been poured and cured. Common dewatering techniques include surface water diversion ditches or groundwater controls such as perimeter subdrains or submersible pumps and gravel sumps. If subgrade conditions don't improve, even with rigorous dewatering efforts, please consult with a geotechnical engineer to explore your options for stabilizing the subgrade prior to boulder placement. Boulders and grout are available at local quarries and concrete plants. It's important that boulders meet the size criteria specified on the plans and satisfy the density and durability requirements listed in district specifications. Boulders are usually blasted rocks similar to riprap, except boulders are individually sorted by size at the quarry instead of being crushed and refined by a mechanical process like what happens with riprap. The district uses 5 standard sizes of boulders ranging from 24 to 48 inches. Although our design guidance is based on perfectly cube-shaped boulders, in practice the boulders we have to work with come in all shapes and sizes. The standard nominal size dimensions, such as 30 or 36 inches, represent the smallest dimension of the boulder or the laying height of the boulder. So if you put a tape measure to a boulder, the smallest side you should measure should be 30 or 36 inches if those are the sizes called for on the plans. We also don't want really long and flat boulders, so the specification also requires that no dimension exceeds 1.5 times the smallest dimension. So if you're using 36 inch boulders, the longest dimension you should measure in any direction should be 54 inches. Boulder sizes and shapes should be checked prior to placement. This can be done at the quarry or on site when boulders start being delivered. When inspecting boulders, it's important to confirm we're not using any with deep cracks that could cause the boulder to split over time. If there are concerns with a particular boulder, it can help to pick it up and simply drop it to see if it splits. The grout mix is similar to a structural concrete mix that contains cement, aggregate, and water. What makes this grout mix unique is it forgoes coarse aggregates and only uses finer aggregate like sand and pea gravel. This allows for easier installation to ensure the grout can flow into all the nooks and crannies around the boulders. Fiber mesh is added to help with durability and to reduce shrinkage cracks. The grout mix design is listed in the district specifications and should be reviewed by the engineer for conformance prior to installation. Boulder placement can start after subgrade prep is complete and the boulders have been approved by the engineer. Typically, the entire boulder field is placed prior to any grout being poured. It may be possible to grout in multiple pours, but this requires approval of cold joint locations and cold joint details such as keyways and embedded rebar that may be necessary to connect the pours to each other. For drop structure applications, boulders should always be placed directly on compacted subgrade without granular bedding, unless approved by the engineer. Granular bedding can create a subsurface flow path that could cause piping of subgrade and subsequent structural failure. Boulders should be placed with the nominal laying height vertical. The top surface should be oriented to generally be flat and closely matching elevations specified on the plans. To minimize grout visibility, boulders should be placed as tightly together as possible without touching, while providing at least 2 to 4 inches of space to allow the grout mix to flow between and fill the gaps. The operator needs to be strategic in selecting and positioning boulders so they fit together like a puzzle. A 2x4 is handy for confirming gap dimensions. If any boulder needs additional support to achieve a level top surface, a few small pieces of rock or riprap can be used underneath in isolated locations. Some grouted boulder structures require weep drains. Verify that weep drains are installed at the locations specified prior to grout placement. Weep drains typically become necessary when the drop height exceeds 1 to 2 feet to assist with seepage control. Grouted boulder drop structures may also include select areas of grout slabs that are steel reinforced. Grout slabs are typically used in less visible areas of a structure, like stilling basins that will typically be underwater or covered with sediment. Rebar size and spacing should be checked prior to a grout pour. It's also important to confirm the rebar mat has proper clearance from the bottom of subgrade and the top of slab. Before placing grout, boulders must be pre-cleaned with a pressure washer to remove any debris, loose soil, or small rock that could prevent grout contact with the boulders. Boulder surfaces should be kept wet on the day of the grout pour to facilitate a thorough connection. After the boulders have been installed and pre-cleaned, it's time to place the grout. Successful completion of a grout pour typically necessitates a large number of laborers on site to assist with pouring, vibrating, and finishing the grout, in addition to cleaning any excess grout that may splash onto the boulders. Grout will typically be delivered by concrete trucks holding up to 10 cubic yards each. It's important to review delivery tickets from the truck driver to confirm the grout matches the pre-approved mix and includes the appropriate quantity of fiber mesh. It's also important to visually verify the grout contains fiber mesh. It typically looks like little plastic hairs. We also need to confirm the mix doesn't contain any coarse aggregate larger than pea gravel. Grout needs to have the appropriate slump to flow between the gaps between the boulders. If water needs to be added on site to improve flowability, make sure the time elapsed from adding water to when the grout is placed does not exceed the maximum allowed in the specifications. Also, be sure to confirm the grout temperature immediately before placement is within the specified range. Grout is typically delivered with a pump using a 4-inch nozzle. Usually a concrete pump truck is utilized for its long reach and convenience of having a remote-controlled nozzle that can be manipulated by hydraulics. Grout should be injected starting with the nozzle near the subgrade and raising it as the grout fills in. Small grouted boulder installations may make use of a concrete bucket in lieu of a pump, but this method is typically not productive enough for use on larger structures where cold joints could form because the pour takes too long. Grout should be vibrated in place using a mechanical pencil vibrator to consolidate the grout and remove any air bubbles. Grout should be placed so that it completely fills all the voids between the boulders. Grout thickness is typically specified as half the boulder height, but no more than 2/3 the boulder height. Keeping the grout level low and leaving more of the boulder height visible improves the appearance, but be sure to consult the design team for any project-specific aesthetic requirements. Grout should be smooth and graded around the boulders by hand with trowels and a brush to provide a broom finish. Boulder cleaning needs to be completed immediately after grout has been placed and before any spilled grout has set up on the visible part of exposed boulders. This is typically done with a bucket of clean water and a plastic brush by hand. After grout is placed and the boulders are cleaned, the grout needs to be cured and protected from hot or cold weather. In hot weather conditions, curing methods include moisture curing or spraying liquid membrane curing compound on the exposed grout surface. If curing compound is used, make sure the contractor is careful not to get any on the boulders. In cold weather, the structure is typically covered with insulation blankets or contained within a heated enclosure to retain moisture and protect the grout from freezing during a curing period. In wall applications, boulders can be placed in single rows or stacked in two rows. To ensure a firm foundation, the bottom row of boulders are usually placed on a layer of small riprap. Boulder walls are considered gravity walls that rely on the weight of the boulders to hold them in place and resist lateral pressures exerted by the retained soil. Careful selection and placement of the boulders is required to ensure stability during stacking. After boulders are placed, grout is poured behind the boulders. During grouting operations, it's important to fill all the voids between the boulders while preventing the grout from spilling out in front of the boulders. This is why grout for boulder walls is typically placed in lifts. Keeping grout recessed from the wall face a distance of about a third the boulder diameter provides an attractive, dry stacked appearance. Keyways and other cold joint details are needed anytime grout is placed in lifts. It's critical to use high quality rock for grouted boulder structures. Most of the boulders produced in Colorado come from mountain quarries in granite formations that produce rock that is heavy, enduring. However, there are some quarries that are not in granite formations and produce less durable rock that can disintegrate over time, as you can see in this drop structure. These started out as solid 36-inch boulders that disintegrated into potato chip-sized fragments. Grouted boulder drop structures need to have a watertight connection between the grouted boulders and the seepage cutoff wall. If the connection is poor, it can lead to a piping condition where subsurface flows erode the underlying subgrade soils and create large voids under the structure. This can result in significant damage and even total structural failure. For guidance on proper construction of seepage cutoff walls, please refer to the district's website and other instructional videos on our YouTube channel. Placing boulders close together and keeping grout levels low helps to minimize grout visibility, resulting in a more aesthetically pleasing finish. However, we sometimes see grout placed too high to the point that it covers the boulder. we also see boulders placed too far apart, which shows more grout than boulders and does not look very attractive. In the past, a technique similar to grouted boulders called grouted riprap was common as a stream and bank stabilization technique. It's important not to confuse grouted boulders with grouted riprap. Grouted boulders use larger rocks of a similar size, whereas grouted riprap uses smaller, well-graded material of various sizes. The smaller, well-graded material present in riprap makes it very difficult to achieve consistent grout penetration, so the district no longer recommends using grouted riprap, and it is definitely not an appropriate substitute for grouted boulders. Grouted boulders are a very useful construction technique with many applications in and along waterways. We hope you found this video helpful in understanding the important elements of achieving a successful installation. For more information, please consult the district's website, where you'll find helpful resources like our construction guidance checklist, criteria manual, and specifications for grouted boulders. Thanks for watching.